I speak to you in the name of the living God, Holy Trinity, ever one. Amen. Good morning.
Good morning.
It is very good to be here with you today, back home in Fort Worth. As you know, I spent the last 2 weeks with several other folks here, your rector and Katie and Patty, at the General Convention of the Episcopal Church. For many reasons, it was a blessing to be there. I was privileged to be a part of the legislative process of the General Convention. Yes, legislative process. For many of you, that may sound thoroughly boring, and certainly not a way to spend one's summer vacation. But for me, it was exciting because we got to participate together in calling the church to fulfill more of God's call in the world, to be more inclusive in our liturgical language, to stand on the side of the oppressed, to seek justice for those who have been sexually abused or harassed. The General Convention voted to do all of these things and much, much more. But legislation was not the only thing that happened at General Convention. Episcopalians, as you may have heard on the news, took a stand against gun violence through daily prayers and through a Sunday rally outside the convention center. And 11 busloads of Episcopalians traveled to the Hutto Immigration Detention Center in Taylor, Texas, to hold a prayer service for immigrants and their children. People in the detention center were not allowed to participate in the prayer service, but many held up notes to the windows, thanking people for coming and praying in their midst. In addition to legislation and political action, four other important things happened. Daily worship, including a very uplifting revival featuring the preaching of none other than the royal wedding preacher himself, presiding Bishop Michael Curry. Fellowship with Episcopalians from around the world. And celebration of ministries like the ones in our own diocese, church plants and food pantries and Christian formation and more. Finally, I don't know about you, but I always enjoy such gatherings more when we take our work seriously and ourselves not too seriously. For evidence that we Episcopalians managed that, you can see more about our relationship with Steve, the General Convention pigeon, who has now his own Facebook page, which you can find by typing in General Convention pigeon into the search bar at Facebook. Katie can tell you more about this. She was on the floor every day. Everyone needs a little livening up now and then, and Steve and his pigeon buddies came to flutter and float and be sure that we knew they weren't doves, very important distinction, and also to leave little occasional presents around the hall. At the closing Eucharist of General Convention, Bishop Jennifer Baskerville Burroughs, who is the Bishop of Indianapolis, gave the final homily. In it, she talked about having a mountaintop experience and then coming down from the mountain to be God's hands and feet in the world. As I heard Bishop Baskerville Burroughs say those words, the mountaintop image that immediately sprang to my mind was one of being here at St. Luke's in the Meadow, this place on the corner of Meadowbrook and Somerset in Fort Worth. Then there was this little thing in the back of my brain that said, not meadow, mountain. I grew up, as many of you know, in the Pacific Northwest with mountains. Mount Hood, 6,000 feet. Mount Adams, 4,500 feet. Fort Worth, 600 feet Not mountain, my brain said. And then I chuckled to myself, because I know the reason that this place came to mind when the phrase mountaintop experience was spoken. It came to my mind because in the kingdom of God, which is an upside down kingdom, mountain is meadow. Mountain is the place where the hearts of the people of God are touched. Not in some lofty location, separated from the pains and cares of the world, but here, where you, my brothers and sisters, have embraced those challenges and pains and have welcomed people into your meadow by making a food pantry here, by welcoming the sometimes chaotic but mostly happy diocesan office to take up habitation in your old nursery school, by welcoming the kids from across the street at the elementary school into this sanctuary to learn music from Tony. Meadow is mountain. Isn't it wonderful that God is where we are? And in fact, as we seek to be where God is, God just comes closer and closer. In today's reading from the Old Testament, we hear that David has called for the Ark of the Covenant of God, which is the seat of God's holy presence, to come down from the hill into the midst of the people in Jerusalem. One interesting thing about this story is that the Ark of the Covenant was in a very stately location up there in the house of Amminadab, the son of King Saul. Probably a nice house, the house of the king's son. The Ark of the Covenant comes down into Jerusalem into a tent, a place that one might not quite deem ready for the presence of God, except David, who loved his people, said, "It's time." And the Ark of the Covenant comes down into the midst of the people, and David leads his people in a dance in the presence of the loving, liberating, life-giving God. And when the Ark of the Covenant, the holiest of holy places, comes to the midst of the people, what's the first thing that happens after dancing? Eating. And the story tells us that David then participates in the distribution of food to all people in equal measure. Bread and meat and a cake of raisins. Enough for all to eat. The presence of God in the midst of God's people, wherever they are. It was noted many times that General Convention also happened in the midst of God's people, in a part of Austin where many, many homeless people live. And we had many occasions to walk outside the convention center and outside our hotels, and we encountered many homeless people on the streets of Austin, many of whom are, of course, caught up in the opioid epidemic and who are in dire straits in many ways. Early on in the week, one of my saintly Episcopal brothers challenged those of us at General Convention not to pass by. Not to pass by, but to greet our brothers and sisters as we encountered them on the road. I had already passed by a couple people, and I thought to myself, I'm going to commit to greeting each person along the road. Years ago, I had a group of young people that made a pilgrimage to Washington, D.C., where they helped in shelters and soup kitchens for a week, and where we had folks from the homeless coalition come to speak to us. And I will never forget when one of our young people asked this homeless woman who had come to speak to us, what do you most long for? What do you most miss? Because this woman had told us that she had had a home that she had lost because of her involvement with drugs. And she said, you would think that the thing that I would miss most is having a steady place to sleep at night. But she said, that's not the thing that I miss most. She said, once I became homeless, the thing that I missed the most was that people stopped looking me in the eye. She said, you know, there were many days when I actually had enough money to buy food because I had asked for money, or I had asked for food at the soup kitchen, and I had enough to eat. And I had a decent place to sleep. She said, I missed connection with people. Those words came back to me as I walked the streets of Austin. And as I thought about the presence of God, being in the midst of God's years ago, Ann and I went to had the privilege to go to Italy. And everywhere in Italy, we saw images of the Annunciation, of Mary receiving the presence of God in her very being. And I was thinking about mountaintops and mountains being meadows, fertile meadows. Meadows where God comes to us. I thought again about Mary's song. My soul proclaims the greatness of the Lord. My spirit rejoices in God my Savior. For he has looked with favor on his lowly servant, the lowliest of servants. The God who casts down the mighty from their thrones and lifts up the lowly. The God who fills the hungry with good things and sends the rich away empty. The one who comes again and again to us in the meadow where the presence of the Lord is, where we, his people, get to participate in change around us, and where we ourselves get to be changed by the loving,